Live from Shadowmere Studios, it's Talkie Box, the Fresh Maker, which might be trademarked.
That's definitely trademarked.
who trademarked it? I've never heard that one before.
It really? Sounds pretty original.
Oh, then I totally made that up.
Okay.
I like it.
And does anybody have a guess of where it might be from?
Yeah, it's definitely not like anything flavorful for your mouth.
No.
Okay.
Nothing minty.
Nothing for freshening of one's breath.
Well, the Fresh Maker is not a sponsor.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we're the Fresh Maker. Dave just said it.
Yeah, that's true.
So we are a sponsor.
We are a sponsor of ourselves. We are our own sponsors. We don't need nobody else. Except please
sponsor
us. We're
strong, independent podcast. I don't need no man.
I have serious codependency issues, so I'm going to need someone to sponsor us. You don't listen to her.
So sponsor Jason.
Yes. Sponsor me, and then I'll sponsor Talkie Box.
# sponsor Jason. It's going to be trending on Twitter.
Yeah.
Speaking of that, I'm your host, Dave. With me is Jason and Justin and Emily. And no one said anything when I said their names.
# sponsor Jason.
So he paused there awkwardly. I wasn't really sure where you were going with that.
Yeah, maybe you were gonna exaggerate on our behalves.
Right. This is Jason, the Fresh Maker.
Jason.
The Fresh Maker.
The Fresh Maker.
Justin, double your pleasure, double your fun.
Mm-hmm.
Emily, other random catchphrase for food.
Ooh.
And Dave,
with the nice hair.
Hey, thanks.
So what have we got today?
This is 21 number one, right? Number 121?
Yeah, number 121.
Yeah.
Season 121.
Yeah. Season 1, episode 2-1.
How do we split up the seasons? Do we
whenever
stop?
I feel like it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's
whenever
going to
we
be...
take a mid-season break.
Eventually, winter is coming. Uh-huh. We've established that.
I drove through the snow on the way here.
So it is cold AF as fuck.
Yeah. Super
yes.
AF as fuck.
Very, very cold AF as frig.
It is going to be spring soon.
It's too late.
It's supposed to be spring already, isn't it?
We sprung forward.
No. We got like another week.
Oh.
Yeah.
The damn clock lied.
Stupid clock.
Well, I mean, you can't spring forward if it's not spring.
It's feeling more wintry on the cusp of spring than it has felt all winter.
That's true.
It's probably going to be snowing on my birthday in August.
Probably.
The world is coming to an end. All right, anyway, today on Talkie Box.
In the Southern Hemisphere. I know. Yeah, it's too bad. I'm going to keep doing it.
I know. So what's up?
Oh, man. I'm having a good time.
So much.
Yeah.
Last time we talked about National Frozen Food Month, which is very, very important.
Right, we had the apple and an ice cube.
As Americans,
yeah.
You can't avoid being a consumer of frozen foods.
I'm not American.
As mostly Americans, you cannot be. You know what? Whatever. We celebrated National Frozen Food Month.
Did we do
that? Which means you're guaranteed to have frozen food.
That's pretty accurate, actually.
Yeah. All of your food comes naturally frozen.
My grandmother has a screened-in porch, and in the winter, it's the outside fridge. Like, legit. It just never gets
Get some bacon off the couch, honey. out of the Florida room.
It was really weird because they got the screened-in porch after I'd moved down here, and so I'd never really experienced it. I went up there for whatever reason to visit for Christmas, and she told me
for Christmas. That was the reason,
probably.
Yeah.
So she told me to go get the ham off the porch, and I was like,
"Why is there ham on the porch?
Why is there ham on the porch?"
But what about bears?
So it's on the second story,
or any sort of wildlife. I mean, listen.
Well, it's screened in.
It was screened in.
You put it in a sack.
Animals can't get through those screens.
You put it in a sack, and then you got to hang it from the highest branch.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And you put a screen around it.
And what about climbing bears? Everybody knows bears can climb.
Oh, those drop bears? I tell you what.
Those what bears?
Those drop bears?
Drop bears.
Drop bears. They'll take your ham.
You heard it first on Talkie Box.
Beware the drop bear. Now, me,
only in Australia, though.
I automatically just picture a bunch of bears jumping out of like a B-52 bomber.
Well, no, it's usually, you know, jumping out of trees. Yeah, you know, catching you off guard, dropping.
They will steal your ham.
They will steal your ham. It's going to happen.
Well, my bears are much more regimented and
regimented
dangerous.
And B-52s?
Yeah.
I like it.
They're flying over. They're all dropping out in uniforms, you know. bear parachutes.
Cute little bears with a cute little army uniform.
Yeah, they're super cute until they rip your face off.
Yep, yep. Yep,
and then all of a sudden, boom, they're on the ground and they're eating everybody's rucksack.
But see, you're from Canada where you have wolverines, right?
So yes. Like,
and those will actually jump out of trees onto people and things.
Yeah, no, they're kind of terrifying. I'm like, reasonably certain that they kept killing our chickens.
Uncanny.
You had chickens?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
With what?
Terrible.
You're terrible.
Yeah.
But we're all terrible.
I saw a video once of a wolverine dropping out of a tree and onto a bear's back, and it took that bear down.
There's a reason that Logan took the name Wolverine.
You mean Hugh Jackman?
Yeah. Yeah, Hugh Jackman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Logan. His name's Wolverine now.
Yeah.
I think it's legally changed.
Reasonably certain.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure he took on a Canadian citizenship just because of Wolverine.
Probably, yeah. Got rid of his Australian accent.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
And now just says, like,
My name is Wolverine. I'm Canadian. Moving on.
Definitely one of my favorite Marvel heroes, though.
He's a lot of people's favorite hero. And I think he's,
it's very nationalist,
he's a cool character, but he's never been anywhere close to my favorite.
I mean, there's the obvious, like, Canadian aspect that I really like about it.
Oh, there's other Canadian superheroes.
There definitely are.
Yeah, but are they Wolverine?
What about O Canada Man?
Just the one.
North Star, isn't that a Canadian?
All of Alpha Flight.
Yeah.
There's
a group called Alpha Flight. Wolverine was part of it.
Okay.
Sasquatch was in it.
Oh, I believe that. Mm-hmm.
Yep. They named a Providence after that guy.
After Sasquatch?
Yeah.
I'm reasonably certain that's a Sasquatch. Oh my God, you're right.
I was thinking of Ontario.
Right. Sasquatch is a surname.
So they named two provinces after him.
Yeah, John Ontario was the very first Sasquatch. I didn't even make the connection that Saskatchewan was.
Susquehanna.
And when he turned into a Sasquatch, he started biting people, and they became Sasquatch as well.
Yep.
It's an entire population.
Did they fight the Northern Vampires?
No.
From the Northern Territories?
Yeah, what else comes out of there?
You don't mess around with that.
The Northwest Territories. Mm-mm.
Canadian vampires.
Canadian vampires. That's why we're so pale.
They're very polite.
What do we call this shitty area over here? In the Northwest? Yeah. Northwest Territories.
That's the long, dark walk to Greenland.
It's...
You're on the wrong side, man.
In 1998, actually, Northwest Territories got split into the Northwest Territories.
The Northwest Territory and the West Northwest Territory?
And Nunavut.
Nunavut.
So,
Kamchatka. Is that how you say bless you?
In
Russian? Yes. Oh. I don't speak Russian. Do you speak Russian? I speak Russian.
Kamchatka? That's a very important place you got to take control of. If you played Risk, you'd know
what
you're talking
about.
Yeah,
I don't. I don't play Risk. Mostly because I don't want to hate everybody. Just post everybody.
It's not Monopoly.
Risk is one of those two games that only end in so many ways. And it's Risk and Monopoly. And every single game lasts at least 4 hours if you're playing it to completion.
Mm-hmm.
And it either ends with everybody getting angry and quitting, or everybody getting pissy and quitting.
That's not true. We played a game of Risk, well, like 5 years ago when we first moved in together.
And you survived?
Yeah, me, Jason, and our former roommate played a game of Risk, and I feel like it was fine.
Yeah.
Right? Like, we played it to completion. I think you won.
No, there were definitely two bitter assholes at the end of that night.
If he won, I should have been one of those assholes, and I wasn't.
It's been a while. Maybe you've forgotten.
I didn't have the choke points. That was the whole thing. Like, you gotta get those choke points.
All I know is you're supposed to get Australia.
No one wants Australia.
I mean, it's
you can't military. Easy. You can't militarize kangaroos.
I'm reasonably certain
it's
you
easy
can.
To
they
defend
kick
Australia, but it's really just not worth a whole lot. Yeah. So it's like it's one of those bunker positions that.
Now, if you can get the whole thing early on, then that's helpful. Because you get more dudes that way.
I mean, really, North America is the most strategically advantageous place in Risk.
This is how you play Risk, everybody.
It's got the three super choke points, Kamchatka, Greenland, and then the Mexico choke point. And it gives you seven armies.
That's four?
That's
several
four.
Things
no,
you said
no,
were not
this
true.
This is seven. I've got three over here.
Okay, you know, couldn't see it, my bad.
They're there. I've got them. You didn't even see the toes. I didn't hold any of them up.
Oddly enough, I've never had a game of Risk that was like, fuck you. Like, I hate you. Like, every game of Risk I ever played was fine.
Really?
I didn't always win either, so I do love winning.
I've only
Risk.
Played half.
Monopoly and Risk both have always ended the same way. Just like, you know what? Yeah. You know what? Fuck this game.
Flipping the board
man.
And all those little colored men.
I'm done.
Can I say that? Can I say colored men?
I mean, like, you know what? Little men and Listen. They're colored multiple colors?
There
I don't
you go.
See why you couldn't say that.
We've
the
been
fact
playing
that you second guessed yourself.
For 4.5 hours. You have Park Place. You have Boardwalk. You have all the fucking railroads. I'm done. I'm done. Like, no, keep playing. Keep playing. No, it's not fun for me anymore, Linda.
Well, I mean, at that point, Linda. Like once you can statistically assure victory in a game like that, then there is already a victor decided. So there's no reason to play it to completion when that moment occurs to every player.
You could
game.
Still win. You can still win. We've all heard
you
people trying
roll,
to encourage.
You could roll 6,417 times in a row and beat me. Like, oh, well, let me start now.
You know,
all right,
you
goodbye.
Know how I know you're winning by an unwinnable margin? You had time to calculate that.
You're not thinking about my next move.
No.
You're thinking about my next 600 moves.
There have been times, like Monopoly, I've definitely just been like, fuck it. I've just given up. Like,
I'm done.
Hey. And then,
done.
You know, but, and it won't even be just me and one other person. It's like me and a group of people. I'm like, and I am out. And I'm like, you know what? I'll sell you everything I have for a dollar.
A real
like
life
a
dollar?
Real life dollar.
No, like one, like an in-game dollar. And then I like.
That's less exciting.
And then I lose all my money in something. I'm like, all right, I'm out. Fuck it.
I'm going to go drink.
See, but I know people
go
who
have fun for a while.
Well, I've known people who get like super pissed when you start like when you are losing in Monopoly and you're like, all right, well, I'm just gonna sell all my stuff to you, and then everybody else cries foul like that's not fair that you're selling it to them for a cheaper price. You're giving them the advantage, and people get really serious about Monopoly.
You just gotta make them pay an inheritance tax.
It doesn't matter. Like at that point, you know, fuck you, man. Yeah, life's not fair. Monopoly's not fair.
This is why I don't play Monopoly.
Some people are born with a couple of extra $1 million in a trust fund to build a Monopoly empire.
Yep.
Some people start with, you know, an apartment in Baltic Avenue.
It's not the best.
Good luck.
Start from the bottom. Now I'm here.
Yeah. Good luck.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
That was a good 15 minutes on board
game. Oh, yeah.
You know what? Well, it was a multiverse of, of conversation.
A lot of free form.
I did mention last month. Because that was actually why I started talking about National Frozen Food Month that led us
Did
into all
mean
this.
Did you week?
Was it a, what month is it?
It's still March.
All right, yeah, meat week.
Meat week.
Meat week.
No, we did
meat
that back
like, That was a long time ago.
Every week is the same week to me. It's episode one every single time. You know that I've
Groundhog played. Week.
Goldfish memory.
Yeah, most people don't know. Jason hasn't left that chair in 4 months.
No, they just turn the lights on and I start talking.
He keeps talking.
But anyway,
that's actually why we started the show, because we were in the chair.
National, international, I think multinational, space national Women's Month. I mentioned it last week.
It was International Women's Day last week.
It's Emily's International Day.
I'm international and a woman.
It would make sense that the day would be in the month.
Yes.
It would.
That they would combine those. It was probably, that there was probably a week, sense. Too. I think they should go ahead and just... Every amount, increment of time that is
International Women's used. Fortnite.
Yeah, International Women's Second.
Why don't we use Fortnite more?
Because we can just say 2 weeks. It's the same amount of syllables.
But it's
I will. I'm henceforth turning in my Fortnite notice.
Don, I'm going to do that all the time.
That's
now.
That's exactly how I'm going
to
quit.
Except that I definitely didn't need to quit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You even got yourself a promotion.
I got
job, didn't
a
you?
Big girl job.
Yeah.
I'm very on International Women's Day. It was awesome.
Congratulations.
So, women in the workforce, women in engineering, woo!
And you're an international woman.
I'm an international woman in a STEM field, because...
Full circle.
Full circle. Wait, what are we circling back to?
Oh, that's just All a song by Aerosmith.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh. That was before my time.
Yep. Love in an elevator.
Liv Tyler, she was an elf.
That's true.
Yes, she was.
She was also in Armageddon.
She was
an elf in Armageddon.
Also an elf in Armageddon.
An elephant in Armageddon. No?
She's really not that big.
No, I meant like a small one. Like one of the
No,
cute
she
ones.
Wasn't an elf. That was Zooey Deschanel.
That was?
Yeah.
Well, anyway, about women's National Women's Month.
International.
International Women's Day.
Interdimensional.
I wanted to discuss the females of our lives that have influenced us. Uh-huh. So just do a sort of a round topic discussion about someone non-family, because obviously when you ask that question to yourself, which I did a couple hours ago,
right.
I said, well, mom.
Right.
You know, that's who the female that influenced me the most. But
and the people in the grocery store was like, why is he talking about
yeah,
mom
this right guy now? Will not leave the melon section. But that's moot. That's not about this. What's about this is that I decided, all right, well, let's take mom out of the equation, because right. that's the go-to. Even if it's not true, they're still going to just be like, well, my mom. So besides that,
yeah.
I just want y'all to kind of think about it for a second. I know Justin is considered one. I actually will go ahead and start because I like to consider myself an entertainer.
Mm-hmm.
I am influenced by Tina Fey. Okay. I think that she is an incredibly dynamic human being. I think that she is an incredibly funny actress, comedian, writer. I love her career story from, you know, going as a writer on Saturday Night Live, becoming the head writer, mm-hmm. to just becoming executive producer, writer of all these other shows that have hit, you know, to movie star. It's very impressive, and I'm very impressed. And
yeah.
And I think she is a leader in her field, no matter what her gender is. And
absolutely.
I am amazed by her.
Tina Fey is fantastic.
She is, and absolutely. She's very, very sexy. Like,
she
I don't
is,
even
she
care.
She's super attractive.
Like, I mean, yeah, her personality definitely increases yeah. that margin.
Absolutely.
But, so that's what I got to say about that.
Yeah.
Thanks, Tina Fey.
Thank you, Tina Fey.
Thanks for listening
for being
watching.
You.
Yeah, when he first told me Tina Fey, I'm like, shit.
Good one.
That's really good. And I had a hard time, like, just like sorting through the clouded Tina Fey spectrum that he had set up.
But, all I can see is Tina Fey.
Yeah, man, it's just Tina Fey everywhere. Amy Poehler? Oh, man.
Too close to the mark.
No, just too close. But I would say J.K. Rowling.
Okay, yeah.
J.K. Good Rowling. One, right? Yeah, he said that. I was like, oh, touche.
That's a good one. You know, wrote 7 books. I think she's written more now. The Harry Potter.
That's right.
The whole the Harry Potters.
Yep.
I grew up reading those books. Like, right. In fact, Harry was always the same age as me as the books were releasing.
Oh, okay.
Even to the point where his birthday's in July, my birthday's in July. So I had a very
I am
like,
Harry Potter.
Very close relation to the
well,
character.
You can give me that scar if you want. Like that.
Yeah, I mean, I have a knife.
Better.
But not only that, but she's garnered like all of these great movie right deals and things like that, to a point where a woman who wrote a children's book is now a multi-billionaire.
Right.
And in case you are unaware, she is also like the Twitter queen.
Oh,
are you
yes.
guys aware of
yes,
this? J.K. Rowling is the Twitter
amazing
queen.
And hilarious.
She is hysterical.
And from what I've heard, like just one of the nicest people that you could ever have the opportunity to meet, mm-hmm. if you ever have the opportunity to meet her.
Yeah, right.
So she also has like a fantastic story. Like she was very impoverished when she started writing the Harry Potter series. She was mm-hmm. actually on welfare. And she was, I believe, a single mother at the time also. And she was driving. No, she wasn't driving the Ford Angelina, but she had one when she was younger. Anyway, the point of this.
Into the microphone.
Sorry. The point of this was she was very, very poor. She was in a very, very bad spot in her life. And if you guys, I don't know if you're really aware of this, but females have trouble breaking into the fantasy genre as a general rule. One of the reasons J.K. Rowling, it's not an effeminate pen name. And it's a problem that we're still having today is female writers are having a really hard time breaking into the fantasy genre, but that she, you know, she wrote a fantastic story, and yeah. now she's like one of the richest people in the world. She actually does not keep any of her money in offshore bank accounts. She pays all of her taxes and does her best to, like, she gives a whole bunch to charity, but specifically she's just like, yeah, I was there. I was like on welfare. Like I needed the government support. I need to give back to the government that gave to me when I needed it. So
good for her.
Go J.K. Rowling. You're a fantastic woman.
Twitter queen extraordinaire.
And Twitter queen extraordinaire.
But what she about, really responds to her fans, too. Like I've seen tons and tons of articles online where, you know, J.K. Rowling answers all the questions from all the fans and everything. And
yeah, she's
they're usually, that. Like, either very, like, you know, people ask some serious life questions and stuff, and she will give, you know, very honest and typically helpful answers.
Ask well, J.K. anything.
Yeah, what I find funny is, like, through her website, I want to say it's Pottermore.com. She actually continues to expand the universe by answering questions that people have. So, like, she will post canonical answers to these questions that people are having, and it's just like it frames the world that much more. And I think it's really, really cool.
I'm a Hufflepuff.
You're a Hufflepuff.
Yeah.
I don't know what I am.
I'm a Ravenclaw.
You haven't been to Pottermore?
It was a long time ago.
Yeah, I was actually one of the beta testers. I really like Harry Potter, which segues into one of the... I actually have two that I want to touch on, important women in my life. Emma Watson.
Okay, yeah. Hermione Granger.
Hermione Granger. Yeah. As a little girl growing up, and I had, you know, I was reading Harry Potter books, and I had my role model was this super smart, nerdy girl who loved books, and she didn't, like, you know, care about, like, necessarily, like, how she looked unless it was, like, something special and she wanted to dress up. Like, she didn't – that wasn't, like, the important part of her life, and she didn't,
and
like
– asshole Ron didn't even notice.
Right? It's okay because her date was Victor Krum. Anyway, but that was, like, my role model growing up was this, like, super, super intelligent, very hardworking woman or girl and who grew into a woman. And she being portrayed by Emma Watson, who then, you know, she went from childhood actress to very strong woman. She's very, what would you call it, like, political. She's
That's a word.
An activist.
Activist. She's an ambassador. Like, she does a lot of work with feminism. She's just a very strong woman. And now she's playing my favorite Disney princess.
Playing Belle.
So,
I know there was a little bit of hubbub about her Vanity Fair spread.
Yeah, but who cares? Like, she can do what she wants.
No, I mean, somebody cares. Nobody here cares.
But that's like, the point is, like, her character has always been, like, it was a little revealing.
Oh. Okay.
So, and that's kind of, like, part of what she stands for is, like, yeah, like, who cares? If I want to do that, I have the right to do that. Yeah. And so, go Emma Watson, go Hermione Granger, go J.K. Rowling. But the other female that really had a very strong influence on my life was actually a physics teacher of mine. My high school physics teacher. She was a nuclear engineer. But decided that she wanted to teach. And so she actually gave up her, you know, engineer position after she'd cut off two of her fingers, lifted up the lab equipment with one hand, picked them up, and then went to the hospital to get them reattached. She's awesome. But she had a... Yeah, she was super hardcore. She had a very strong influence on the STEM aspect of my life. She ran the robotics club at my school, and she really encouraged, like, everybody to join, but particularly women because, you know, we can. And she was just like, why don't you want to, like, why wouldn't you want to do this? There's robots and it's awesome. So
who doesn't like robots?
Exactly. And when I was going to college, and we did grow up very, like, I did grow up very, very impoverished, and I got accepted to school, but I couldn't afford the acceptance deposit. We just didn't have the money for it. And I went to her crying after school one day, like, just, I couldn't, you know, like, just bawling, didn't know what to do. And so she sat me down and was like, we're going to get through this. She helped me apply for financial aid. She actually co-signed all of my loans.
Oh, wow.
You know, she really made sure that I could. And then she got me a scholarship through the robotics club so that I could afford the acceptance deposit.
That's awesome.
So,
that's cool.
Go, Miss Geddes. I love you. You're a very strong influence in my life. And I wouldn't be the woman that I am without her.
And hopefully she's watching.
And hopefully she's watching. God, maybe hopefully she isn't watching. So what about you, Dave?
Mine, I have these three women who, they're not celebrities like a couple of y'all's were, but they're women, they're not my mom, but I actually refer to all of them as mom. And they're the mothers of three of my friends that I've had throughout my life.
Mm-hmm.
One of which was a teacher. She's actually an international woman because she's from South Africa.
Ooh.
And she recently, just in the past 10 years, gained citizenship. She's been here for 30 plus years, I think. But she was a teacher for pretty much that entire time she was here in America, and in not the best area, but you know, she's a strong lady, and she you know, any kids gave her some shit, like she was up their ass about it. That's my buddy Will's mom, and then my buddy Les's mom, who lives over in Alabama, and she's been kind of just like a homemaker for a large portion of her life, but mm-hmm. but just recently she started up her own business in Huntsville, Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember the name of the town that she lives in anymore. But you know, just out of nowhere, she was like, you know what, I want to get out there and do something, and she's doing a great job. She started up a shredding business for companies that want to, you know, they need to get rid of some of their old documents and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so she started up her own kind of shredding business out of nowhere, and it's apparently thriving, and she's doing a great job.
Nice. That's
and then impressive. There's my friend Tammy's mom, who was a swim coach for years and years and years, and she lost her husband, who I referred to as dad, a few years back, and she was so strong about it. Like she pushed through it, and it wasn't until like I saw her kind of alone where I really saw her, like she finally let herself go and everything, and I thought it was really, like, she didn't have to do that. She didn't have to, you know, put on this act that everything was okay, but mm-hmm. she did, because she wanted to be there for the rest of the family and everything, and I saw that, and I was like, wow, that's really empowering. That's really powerful and pretty amazing. So my moms, who did not give birth to me, are just some of the greatest ladies that I've had the pleasure to get to know.
To Dave's moms.
Yeah. To Dave's moms.
To all moms. To all women.
Yep.
That was really awesome.
Heavy.
Yeah. Heavy.
Yeah. Well, cheers, ladies.
Thank y'all, international women and domestic women.
And also women on other planets that we don't know about.
Interdimensional women.
All the single ladies. All the single ladies.
All the single ladies.
Put your hands up.
All the single ladies. So,
and Beyonce. What a strong woman. No, seriously, though, actually. She's actually a really great role model.
Yeah, she is physically strong.
How do you put that? Like a lot of mothers think that she's a really great role model, and then a lot of other mothers are like, what are you talking about? Like, she dresses up like super, like not a whole lot of clothes, and dances mm-hmm. around, and it's like, yeah, and she wants to, and she can, and she is empowered to do that, and if that's what makes her feel good, then she's more than welcome to do it. Yeah. So go Beyonce.
I've never really been a huge fan of her music, but it doesn't take away from her as a person.
Mm-hmm. No, she's very inspiring.
There was one time when I really didn't like her, though, and it was around the time of Destiny's Child, when apparently, so how many women were in Destiny's Child?
Beyonce.
There's also a couple others.
I feel like there was four or three.
There was originally five.
There was five.
There was five.
Wow.
And they fired two of them and didn't tell them. And they didn't know it until the song for, I don't remember. It was one of the very first songs that Destiny's Child had. The video for it came out, and those two women weren't in it.
Ooh.
Their voices were in it, but they weren't. And then they're like, what's this about? And they're like, oh, we didn't tell you? Sorry.
Oh.
By the way, you're fired.
You're fired.
Wow.
And it was apparent, like, from things I read, it was a lot of Beyonce's influence, because her dad was like their manager, I think.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And he had adopted one of the other girls in it.
And her mom was their like costume designer, yeah. Choreographer.
So like Beyonce was pretty much that group. And apparently it was kind of her thing, like, yeah, I don't really like these other two girls, and maybe we should get rid of them. And they're like, yeah,
they're
whatever.
Stealing my spotlight, and I like the spotlight.
Yeah.
Of course, like, how old was she at that point?
Early 20s, maybe?
Yeah.
Maybe late teens, but I think early 20s.
Like, I mean, I've done some stuff in my late teens, early 20s.
Do go on.
That was very narcissistic.
Yeah.
So
I think everybody does.
That doesn't make it okay.
Yeah. It's not making it okay, but it.
And I'm not saying she hasn't learned from that.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't know, but that put a really bad taste in my mouth for a long time when the whole Destiny's Child thing was starting.
Because it's like, that's an exploitive narcissism. Like, it's one thing to just think that you're the fucking cat's meow all the time, even when you're obviously not. But but it's a whole nother thing to have like an exploitive nature of people, or to let them believe one thing when obviously the complete opposite thing is the truth.
All right, listen, I'm the ticket to making this work, so fuck everybody else.
And to be honest, she's right.
Well, like,
she's wrong. She's the one who's still around, still in the spotlight. Mm-hmm. Kelly Rowland, to a much lesser extent, and I still can't remember the third one's name.
Michelle Williams.
Oh, was it?
Oh, she's still around, right?
Is she?
Yeah, man, not really.
No? That name rings a bell.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's her name.
You guys just sounded like a Sesame Street cartoon, like talking to each other. You guys know. Oh, maybe.
It's been a while since I saw Sesame Street.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm talking about Sesame Street, circa 1984.
Yeah, wasn't around.
Right when the computers were taken
over. Right when the aliens, robots, Terminator, you know.
So I got a fun little tech topic that I wanted to talk about really quick. Kind of techie a little bit, and I wanted to get your guys' opinions on it.
Yeah.
All right, so.
I agree.
Perfect.
I don't.
Moving on.
Oh.
To the future.
Onward. Onward and upward. So, watches.
I don't
wear them.
Some people.
We've been trying to get these people to watch us for a long time.
Watch us now. Some people wear watches.
Uh-huh.
Some people don't wear watches.
Yeah.
Some people wear fitness trackers. Some people wear smart watches. Some people wear super expensive luxury watches.
Yeah.
And I feel like everybody has a justification for why they choose to wear the watch that they do or choose not to wear watches.
Right.
But I have noticed a trend in smartwatches. I'm seeing more and more smartwatches now than I've seen ever.
Mm-hmm.
And
since their invention?
Yeah, ever. Like I just said.
They've been around for a little while.
They've been around for a little while. They're just now getting to the point where
like
they're
30, 40 years ago? You barely saw any.
They're advanced enough that they have like
multiple applications.
Yeah. No, yeah. I actually had a smartwatch. I think I got it 2 years ago, and I just don't wear it because it doesn't have the functionality that.
See, I wear a smartwatch, but it just links into the whole Apple ecosystem that mm-hmm. I'm in, so it has a lot of functionality for mm-hmm. me. But the things that I don't understand are the luxury watches. I can understand why people don't wear a regular watch.
Mm-hmm.
I can understand why people wear just a fitness tracker if it tells the time and if it tracks their fitness. That's all they're really trying to get out of it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But wearing these super expensive watches that do nothing else.
Except tell the time.
It kind of boggles my mind. And sometimes they don't do that very well.
I mean, it's the same with anything extravagant, though. Like, mm-hmm. I drive a super fancy car because I have the money to get that.
Yeah.
I wear a super fancy watch because I have the money to get a watch made entirely out of
downtown apartment that costs five times more than the one three blocks down the street. Yeah. Or...
So like, I was... One of the first criticisms that I saw coming out when, like, the Apple Watch and the Gear 2 and all that other stuff was really starting to come to the forefront was, you know, why spend so much money, you know, $300, $400, $500, $600 on a watch when they can get a $20 watch at, you know, Kohl's and it does the same thing. But then you have these luxury watches, and I was looking up some prices on them just to, like, see the justification, and I looked up Rolex. I figured just be broad, start with Rolex. The cheapest one I found was just under $4,000.
Yeah.
The most expensive one I found was a Platinum and Pave Dial Daytona.
What is Pave?
I have no idea, but it makes the watch cost $130,000.
I'm too poor to know what Pave is, apparently.
Yeah. Like, this one watch.
If I ever accumulate enough money, somebody would be like, by the way, here's your check. Pave.
Well, he said Impave.
No, Pave. Platinum
and Pave.
Platinum and Pave Dial Daytona, $130,000. Most expensive watch. For a watch.
For something that tells you what time it is on your wrist.
Yes. That is correct.
That is redonkulous.
It's insane. Now.
Maybe Pave is like a Spanish word for diamond or something.
It could be.
Platinum and Pave. It sounds like Pave would be.
Don't you have an internet box right there? You can look up Pave.
I mean, we can see what Pave is.
I need to know.
Yeah.
At this point,
I'm very curious.
Is it a type of metal? I don't think it's a type of metal. And
it sounds like something that's related to kale.
Yeah. Like a platinum and pave sandwich.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's $130,000.
Yeah. I got one from Starbucks the other day, but it was a little out of date. Like, it was starting to get brown on the ends.
It's funny. So there's this kid at work who works in our dish pit at the restaurant I work at during the day. And he has a smartwatch, like a Samsung or something.
Mm-hmm.
But he works in a dish pit. He didn't want to get wet.
Yeah.
So he gave it to me to wear one night. And like, I haven't worn a watch since I was like 16 years old.
It's apparently a style of watch face.
Pave is?
Pave. It means to like a pavestone.
Yeah, it's where they take a whole bunch of gemstones and set them very, very, very close together so it almost looks paved or tiled.
So is it pave or is it pave?
It's pave.
Oh.
Yeah, there's definitely an accent there.
Ah, pave.
Yeah, so what they're saying is that the watch is made out of platinum, and there is a shitload of diamonds in there also.
Super paved. Fancy.
Paved with diamonds and platinum.
Ooh.
Yes, $130,000.
You buy a house for that watch.
Right? Yeah.
You could.
Yeah, but it's a whole house. Its fence value is going to go way down.
Way down.
Yeah, you'll pay
the house or the watch?
40.
Well, both, depending, really.
That's why you should go with like Rolex instead of Rolex.
Rolex.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like wrought iron is actually a really good investment for fences.
I wouldn't know.
Yeah, that's probably true.
Yeah.
So anyway, this kid.
So this
got
kid
this Samsung
got the
smart
Samsung
watch. Thing,
watch.
Uh-huh. And I wore it for like 6 hours, and it was so heavy on my wrist. And you know, for like at most, I wear like a hair tie or something on my wrist for my hair. And to wear this watch, I was like, this is, it just felt so awkward and weird. And it was actually a little bit smaller, I believe, than what you have there.
Mm-hmm.
Like it was more, I believe, if I recall correctly.
It was probably circular?
No, it was basically the width of the band.
Ah.
Mm-hmm. And so it was sort of rectangular that way.
Well, that was,
I don't
that
understand
was
the, how you wear it.
Oh, I mean, it's not that heavy. And after a while, you know, just like anything else, you get used to it.
Yeah.
Like.
Because. I have the Fitbit Charge HR, and it's lighter than I had the Samsung Gear Live.
Mm-hmm.
It's lighter than that, and it just has better functionality. I couldn't get a lot on my Samsung watch. It just like calls and texts, but you have to be in range of your phone, so you got to be carrying your phone anyway.
Yeah,
and it just wasn't really doing it for me. I really like the Fitbit because it, you know, tracks things like my heart rate, my steps, how far I've traveled, that sort of thing. And so it gives me a better idea of how I'm moving on a day-to-day basis. A lot of the smartwatches will have pedometers in them.
Mm-hmm.
I find that they're not as accurate. I actually, my one gripe about the Charge HR is that it is not as accurate as the one that I had, which is doesn't have the heart rate attachment on it, but you keep it on your center of gravity so you don't get like messed up steps.
Really?
So
my gripe about that is that it's not a sponsor.
It is not a sponsor.
It's not a sponsor.
They did just come out with the new one that I'm going to try though. So
which
maybe
could be a sponsor.
Could be a sponsor.
Hashtag sponsor Jason.
Right.
What about you, Jason? You don't wear a watch, I don't think. I've never seen you wear a watch, really.
Yeah.
No, but it's for reasons, and I will share them with you.
Thank you.
When I was a young man, I was much more a slave to my disorders, and I had to have a watch. I couldn't, like, I'd wake up and I'd put it on, like, immediately, and I just, like, I had to have the representation of time
mm-hmm.
all the time. And I would actually find myself staring at it and like getting lost in thought scenarios and stuff like that when I would use it for like contemplation. Eventually, it got hung up in the spokes of a tire, and it ripped off of my wrist and almost broke my wrist. Now that didn't stop me from getting another watch. But then upon like the third,
you start putting your wrist near spinning tires.
Well, spinning things in general, but just getting snagged on random stuff, like from it being a car door or just any random thing. I was always, from that one moment, mm-hmm. from that point on, like I had no more control over it. Like I would just get snagged on stuff constantly, and I developed a weirdness about it. So I just decided, like, just no more watches.
Yeah.
Because one day I'm going to lose my hand. And besides, I actually didn't even need... I could tell you what time it was most of the time without looking at the
watch.
What
time is it?
Right now?
Yeah.
It's 8:29.
Nope.
No, way off.
No.
Mm-mm.
Well.
Yeah.
It's because you've been so long without a watch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. You're within an hour, though.
Yeah.
Oh, that's like good.
40 minutes behind.
Plus or minus.
Huh?
Yeah. It's 40, a large 42 tolerance. Minutes behind.
What time is it?
42 minutes behind.
So, in manufacturing environments.
So it's seven?
It's seven.
Nine?
Closer.
Oh.
In manufacturing environments.
We did just spring forward.
Oh, right. Yep, there you go. That's what it was. You can't wear jewelry. You can't wear bracelets or watches. Manufacturing environments, which I said a couple times.
He was talking.
Oh, right. Because of the risk of, like, you know, getting caught on things.
Right.
So I actually heard, I don't know if this is true, I heard this a long time ago, that you used to wear your wedding ring on your right hand because, you know, like, your right hand's your dominant hand. It's an important hand. But in the Industrial Revolution, people were getting their rings caught on machinery because
they used their right hand.
Because they used the right hand for it. And so they created this whole propaganda of, you know, left hand is the hand of the heart, and that's where you should have your ring on your left hand. And that's why that happened. Has anybody heard that before?
I'd never heard that, but it makes perfect sense.
It does make sense, yeah.
Yeah, a lot of other countries, too, in other cultures, you'll wear your wedding ring on your right hand because...
Less industrial countries?
Countries where the Industrial Revolution didn't hit necessarily at the same time.
Hmm. I've checked out some old marriage practices, but I was actually unaware of the fact. Like, I knew left hand for the heart, but I didn't know that was a... somewhat recent development.
Yeah,
I thought it had always been.
So. I didn't know that for a long time. But...
I mean, just a wedding ring in general is a more or less recent development.
Yeah.
Like, there was typically a giving of some sort of gift, but the ring thing, from what I understand, is largely pushed by De Beers.
Yeah.
The largest diamond owners in the world.
I know that.
It should just be a ring.
Yeah, the engagement ring specifically.
Yeah.
Because the marriage ring shouldn't have stones in it. It should be a perfect circle.
The band?
Yeah. It should have Tool, or Maynard, I'm sorry, from Tool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
You should always have him on your hand.
Yeah, you
always have a Tool on your hand.
Be okay with that. I
Schism.
I didn't really look up a whole lot of marriage practices. I feel like Dave might be a little bit more familiar as someone
who's... I just know how to perform the wedding.
Performed marriages before.
Do you? What about you? Duns.
Both of you? Nice.
Dunsy. Let's drink.
Husband, wife.
Oh, by
the way... a lot of finger guns going on.
Missed out on finger
If anyone
guns.
At home actually wants Talkie Box Dave to perform their wedding...
I can do that for you.
Contact us at talkiebox.net via... Hey, Dave, perform my wedding.
Is there like a box or something on TalkieBox.net?
There can be. I can make that happen.
Okay.
You can put it in the comments for this video or audio, whichever you prefer.
Yeah. Say, P.S. Dave, we want you to marry us.
Our email address is on there.
Yeah. TalkieDave@TalkieBox.net. Wait, that's not real yet.
That's not a thing.
Yet.
Yeah. Yet.
So TalkieBoxPodcast@gmail.com.
There we go.
Yeah.
This is where I'm trying to.
And we'll even put some of your, the better clips of your wedding on the show.
Absolutely. You will sign off on that.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a request.
Nope. That's just part of the deal.
Yep. They will show reasonable up. Rates. Yeah.
Jason is allowed to wear Aladdin garb to your wedding.
Yeah. I like to wear really, really tiny vests.
And you gotta let it happen. Wear a white dress?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's the only way it works.
Everyone on the show here is invited to your wedding, by the way.
Oh, yeah. You knew that.
Yeah.
They knew.
We're all coming.
You wanted us there.
And I'm going to complain about the cake.
Yeah. Jason is the complainer. I'm the minister. Justin is the dancer. And Emily is...
going to be in a white dress.
Going to be in a white dress.
She's the distraction.
Look for her in the white dress, ladies and gentlemen.
No, you know, you got to have somebody that shows up to just ruin your time, right? But if it's one of your friends, you're going to be personally insulted. So if it's me,
A perfect stranger.
Perfect stranger. You're going to just be like, oh, it's Emily from Talkie Box.
Yeah, there's no way you're going to get hit in the face.
You're in. Yeah, but it won't have all of the emotion behind it, you know?
No, it would probably have more. So I don't know who this bitch is, but I'm going to beat her ass.
So how that's hilarious. Hilarious.
Hey, that's Emily from Talkie Box.
How hilarious is this, right? You know how embarrassing it is.
She's about to be Emily from Gummy Box.
To be in a social situation and see that someone else has worn your clothing.
I get real excited. I'm like, oh my God, twinsies!
No,
but how would you feel if, like, you were the bride and some stranger just showed up in your wedding dress in the audience? Like, oh, I was just wearing this for because I thought it was a wedding, so...
Who the hell does she think she is?
And then she pipes up from the eyes, twinsies!
Twinsies! I thought you might wear this. I wore white, too.
Oh, my God, I went to David's Bridal and I asked what dress that you got so I could, like, match accessories for you, and then I just bought your dress.
David's Bridal is not a sponsor of Talkie Box.
It's in two sizes smaller than yours.
Emily is great about product placement we do not place.
This is the David that we're talking about from David's Bridal. You can find him on TalkieBox.net.
Yep.
Say, dear David, marry us and buy me a dress.
He'll marry you.
He will not buy you a dress.
No, I'll buy you a drink. Congratulations. Hey. But that's what your husband
does. That's a tall order.
Right? To buy you a drink?
Yeah.
Or a dress.
But no, not married.
I'll buy you a drink.
Yes.
Not you, though.
I'm going to need a dowry.
Are you my father?
I'm going to need a doily.
Oh, I can make those.
Yeah. It has to be a doily.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
I want a dolly.
A dolly?
Like the push, you push things around on, or you push it around in a stroller?
Miss Parton.
The one that he can brush her hair?
Like from Dollywood?
Dolly Parton?
Yeah.
Got it.
Yep. Wow.
I heard Miss Parton, and I was like...
Nope. Miss Parton. Nope. Mrs. Parton?
I don't know.
Dave's a cuddler.
I would believe Mrs. I think she's married.
She does a lot of things with literacy and young children. She will, if you sign up, you can actually get free books.
I believe at one time, wasn't she illiterate herself?
She's a big fan of
reading. I mean, I think we all are.
No, I believe we're.
But,
I understand
but
what not
like,
you're
yeah,
saying.
But the other, right.
Like at an
My
age
mom
that it should have been.
Right.
Into her belly. Like my mom would press braille books into her belly so that I could read.
ABC, motherfucker.
Like, mom, this story is so trite. Yeah.
Go the fuck to sleep.
The alphabet by Sammy Jack. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Is G a country you ever heard of, motherfucker?
Twinkle, twinkle, little snake on a plane.
We gotta get Sam Jackson.
I don't think he would do it.
I don't think so.
He likes to be one.
I'm charming as shit. I can get his shit.
Maybe you should offer to marry him.
I will. I bet he's married.
I think
renew his vows?
I can do that.
There you go.
There are probably plenty of famous people that would be happy to help us out. However, getting through the red tape of like people that are invested in those people that don't want us to have anything to do.
Hey there, viewer. Dave here from Talkie Box. Do you know someone famous? You should tell them about Talkie Box. I'm looking at you. Ding!
Siri. Tell the world about Talkie Box. Okay.
Hey, Siri. Contact someone famous.
Have we tried that one yet?
We're famous. I don't have an iPhone. What?
Siri was acting a bitch earlier.
Yeah, Siri was acting.
She was being super sassy.
So, have you heard of the Amazon Echoes and Alexa?
Yes, I did, and I found out something interesting.
Oh, what did you find out?
So, you're probably do you know about this?
Yes.
There's Alexa with the Amazon Echo, which is like Siri and Cortana and all.
Yeah,
that
it's their AI. Right.
And so, people have been asking it: Are you connected to the CIA? And when you do that, it will, like, shut itself off.
What?
And people are like, oh, my God, it's going to the CIA. It doesn't want me to know. Holy shit. Blah, blah, blah. That's bullshit.
It's like, see, hey, Alexa, would you lie to me? No. Hey, Alexa, who's CIA? CIA is a Central Intelligence Agency. Hey, Alexa, are you connected to CIA?
And it just shuts off.
And it's like,
thinking. Yep. I mean, hey, Alexa, are you connected to the CIA?
Couldn't they just lie? No.
Well, you know why it does that? Because you could ask, are you connected to Elmo? You could ask, are you connected to a TV?
Oh, that's right.
When you do that, it's literally looking for a connection to whatever you just said.
Yep.
So, like, it's looking for, like, a Bluetooth connection, and since you don't have anything in your house called CIA, it's like...
So, for anybody, any of your viewers who don't know, the Amazon Dot and the Amazon Echo are devices that are used to connect all of your Bluetooth and Wi-Fi devices together. So, and you interface with it through voice commands, and the AI is named Alexa. So you'd be like, hey, Alexa, turn on the TV. And if you have the smart TV, she'd turn on the TV for you. Or
because you can't push that button yourself.
Or,
I mean, if your hands are full of, you know, masturbating, because you're probably that 40%.
Why are we at work with an Alexa with an Amazon Echo?
Why not?
Weird. So it's actually,
if I had one, it'd be in the middle of the table.
It's actually this really cool, like, first step, in my opinion, to like a smart house where you've got everything connected. I know there are a lot of
that movie that did not work out well.
Smart house.
I've never seen it, but we ovens, certain ovens, higher end ones, have Wi-Fi and Bluetooth connections, and
same with fridges.
Yep. So yeah, all of the appliances.
I have the smart lights. I have the smart lights, so like it's connected to my Apple TV and like Siri and all that other stuff. So I can either get on my watch or my phone, my earphones, or my Apple TV remote, and if I say good night, it turns off all of my lights.
That's really cool.
When I leave, all of my lights turn off. When it recognizes that I am back within my geofence, it turns my lights back on. And I can have it set up to like automatically turn on lights at different settings at different times of different days, and it's
my dishwasher really cool. Calls me if I come home late.
Are you okay?
Yeah, like,
okay, like they're clean. You're gonna get spots on them.
It's been a couple hours.
You really need to unload me.
Those plastic cups did flip over. They're still filled with dirty water.
You're gonna have to wash these again. That's my fault. Sorry.
Will you just let me know when you're coming home?
But I think it's a really interesting first step. It was a very popular item at Christmas this year. The Echo.
Oh.
The ovens.
Not the smart oven.
Not the smart oven. That was at Black Friday sales. But yeah, so it's this really cool first step to like the interconnected house, the interconnected, like you said, the entire, what did you call it, Apple environment.
Ecosystem
that you've got.
Is that what they call it? Is that what you call it?
Yeah, it's called the Apple ecosystem.
Yeah, oh. and so you have all of these interconnected devices in every aspect of your life. It could be Skynet.
Yeah.
It definitely is the precursor to Skynet.
It definitely is.
This is Cyberdyne Systems we're talking about.
Like, but it's awesome.
Alexa is really cool because you can just like, or Echo exactly or whatever you want to call it. Like, it can just sit in the room and it's always listening for you to say Alexa. And it's when it's ready to take commands. And you incorporate it onto like a smart home hub.
I can see it getting jealous when you say some other girl's name. It's like, who's this Cindy bitch?
So I work with Alexa.
If I had Alexa and Siri at the same time, I feel like they'd end up getting really catty with
me. That's the thing.
Hey, Alexa, what's the news today? What's the matter, Justin? You don't want me to read you the news anymore?
Like, I'm not worried about AI becoming self-aware. I'm worried about AI becoming aware of other AI and getting real
pissed
off.
Who the fuck is this bitch?
I've got a Windows one, so I have
everything
Cortana.
Was cool when I was the artificial intelligence. Yeah.
It's
now
also...
I see it's a competition.
So if I come over with Cortana, like... She probably be like, hey, I don't want to go in there with those bitches.
It's also interesting that, you know,
they were very rude to me last time.
We've got Cortana and Siri and Alexa, and they're all female voices.
Yeah.
And I think that says a lot about our culture. We're more willing to trust a female voice.
Well, actually, a friend of mine, I was out having a few drinks, and we got talking about, you know, the Echo and all this other stuff. And apparently there's a recent update or something like that where you can address the Echo or the Dot differently. Mm-hmm. Like, there are different settings. Like, you can call it Alexa, say, hey, Alexa, or you can call it Amazon, or you can call it computer.
And hello, computer.
That seems like the computer. Most viable option. Like, computer, check on this statistic for me.
Very Star Trek, The Next Generation. Mm-hmm.
Computer, turn on my television set.
You know,
very good computer.
What you mentioned about them all being women is kind of funny that no one's really, as far as I know, no one's brought up like, why does it gotta be a woman? Why it has to be a woman?
They have.
Well, I mean, with Apple, you can set Siri to be different voices. Like the common one is the American female, but there's also an American male Siri voice.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
There's an Australian and a British male and female voice.
I want like a Patrick Warburton or a Cat Williams or something like that.
Well, Sam Jackson, like, what you want, motherfucker?
Yeah. Ask me again.
Playing the song.
What?
Greece.
Say what again?
Say what? But it's interesting though that they do have the default voices to be effeminate, and in some other countries they've run into a problem with that.
Really?
Of, well, I'm not taking orders, like for GPS, it's like I'm not taking orders from a woman.
I'd rather listen to Snoop Dogg tell me which way to go.
But Siri is also more of like a personal assistant voice too, so I think that it's
right.
It's so almost kind of the wrong
that,
way.
That aspect also is...
That's
is,
what I was talking about. Mm-hmm. Like, it's like, why's it got to be a woman
submissive.
That's taking all these orders? You know?
Why can't it be Patrick Stewart?
Why can't it be Patrick Stewart? I would love to have Patrick Stewart.
Listen, I would pay probably $20 a set if an actor were to go and like record all the things that the person who voices Siri has done over the years just to make sure that it could say anything that your phone would say.
Yeah.
I would pay any amount of money for those like voice packs.
Not any amount. He's kidding about that.
Like $20.
His own money. I don't care.
Yeah. Like $20.
He started at 20. Then he went to infinite.
Any amount.
I'll give you my children.
Somewhere between 20. But,
like
and everything.
Introducing the H. John Benjamin Siri pack. Ooh. I would pay $20 to have H. John Benjamin give me directions.
And H. John Benjamin would let you pay him $20 to give you directions. Yeah. He would sit in the back and give you like, all right, your hour's up.
All right, playing alternative radio. Like, perfect.
Thanks, Archer.
Thanks.
He is a very dynamic voice actor.
He has a very distinctive
and
voice.
And he's not terribly, terribly far from this place.
No. Archer is made in Georgia.
Let's go crash their party.
Yeah, just a little. I tried that one time.
How'd that work out?
They are not cool with it.
Oh.
They don't like you just, hey, do you have any passes? No? Okay, well, you are going to have to get the fuck out of here.
I had the chance. I had the chance to DM for the animation team.
Really?
And you chose to not.
Because
do
my
that.
Co-DM didn't want to give up Friday Night Magic.
I actually know one of the guys on the animation team for Archer.
Yeah, could have
DM'd. I don't know if he's still there, but he was for a while. He used to work on Frisky Dingo and C-Lab 2021.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Mac.
You definitely saw a shift in their animation style between like season 1 and 2 of Archer to season 3 is when I feel like it's still the same core concept of animation, mm-hmm. but the cuts and the angles that they used in the regular animations that they used
bless you.
Thank you.
Changed a lot.
Archer is my spirit animal. I think I've told y'all that before, but he is. I really like him. I like what a terrible human being he is, but like how he constantly just like, oh, you were useful after all, but we still don't like you, but we see your usefulness.
He has stores and stores of useful and completely useless information.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he's such an ass about his presentation in every regard. Ah, he's delightful. I love him.
It's wonderful.
Not a sponsor.
Not a sponsor, though. One day.
Yep.
Not a sponsor.
We're gonna keep knocking.
Please don't knock on the table.
Knock, knock, knock.
There you go.
Talkie boxes door.
On heaven's door. Which is right next to 8th, 4th, and 8th.
I don't want that. You gotta take a stairway up there. It's so far.
No, I think you have to buy that.
The stairway to heaven.
Yeah, you have to buy that.
I'm not buying that. That sounds expensive as shit.
It's going to be real expensive.
What if I take a Zeppelin?
Otherwise, it's the fire escape ladder to heaven.
Fire escape ladder to heaven.
Yeah. And your palms get
sweaty. Those aren't meant to climb up.
They are not meant to climb up.
Yeah, your palm spaghetti.
Palm spaghetti.
Yeah, palm spaghetti.
Your palms get sweaty
halfway. Spaghetti on the sweater already?
Yeah.
Mom spaghetti?
All right. Well, now we're just talking nonsense.
Spaghetti.
Yeah, we really are. All right.
Well, that's actually pretty much it for the show. Anyway.
Yeah.
How much more time do we have?
Like a minute.
Like 60 seconds?
Like that.
All right. Well, we should
go ahead and do
some shout-outs. I promised a drunk guy named Clay Coker that I would tell the world that he is our illustrator for the talkie bot.
He drew the talkie bot.
He drew this talkie bot, and He can draw other things too, nope. Not actually, just talking bots. Actually, yeah,
no, Clay's really good.
He's really good. Yeah. He could be a professional if he were motivated.
I'm pretty sure he does a lot of work. Pretty motivated to draw, that's what I'm trying to say.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He's motivated to draw, but he's not motivated to sell.
Sell. Sell. Capitalism.
You gotta sell out if you're a real artist.
Did we pay for the talkie bot?
Hmm? He donated.
I gave him a handy.
Okay.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Talkie Box telling you when putting together the puzzle that is life, beware the pieces aren't jigsaw, they're Lego. Don't step on them.
Okay.
And also handies.
Please
know
it. That's it. Have a great night.
Have a great night.
God bless. Have a great night.